This week on Vaticano, Pope Francis meets with the Charity and Health Commission of the Italian Bishops' Conference as the Italian government begins discussions on the legalization of euthanasia and assisted suicide. We catch up with the former Vatican spokesman, Father Federico Lombardi, on the anniversary of Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI's resignation. Stay with us to discover how Lourdes became one of the biggest Marian shrines in the world, attracting millions of people every year. For this and more, Vaticano starts now. During the Angelus prayer on February the 12th, Pope Francis reflected on Jesus' Sermon on the Mount from the Gospel of Matthew. The Holy Father said that in this passage, Jesus wants to help his listeners to better understand the Mosaic Law. What was said in the Old Covenant was true, but he came to fulfill this law, said Pope Francis.
A justice animated by love, charity, mercy, and therefore capable of realizing the substance of the commandments, avoiding the risk of formalism. Formalism, this I can do, that I cannot. Up to here I can, up to here I cannot. No, more, more.
Pope Francis dwelled in particular on three commandments of the Old Testament, murder, adultery, and swearing. The Holy Father said that sin is first conceived in our hearts, and once it roots there, it's made real through our bad behavior.
A tutti voi.
I wish you all a good Sunday, and don't forget, do not insult. Do not give bad looks or looks with intentions of possession at a woman who is not your own. Do not swear. These three things Jesus says, it's not so hard.
Tre cose che Gesù dice, è tanto facile.
On February the 10th, Pope Francis met with the Charity and Health Commission of the Italian Bishops' Conference on the eve of the 25th World Day of the Sick.
Business models of healthcare, if adopted in an indiscriminate fashion, risk producing human waste rather than optimizing the available resources. To optimize resources means to use them in an ethical and responsible manner and not to penalize the most fragile.
The audience took place a few days before the upcoming discussion by the Italian government about the legalization of euthanasia and assisted suicide.
Together with lights, there are also shadows which risk endangering the experience of our sick brothers and sisters. If there is a sector in which the throwaway culture makes most visible its painful consequences, it is exactly that of healthcare. When a sick person is not placed at the center and considered in their dignity, attitudes arise which can even lead to profiteering on other people's misfortunes. And this is a very serious issue.
E questo è molto grave.
The Holy Father pointed out and praised the many health institutions in Italy, founded on Christian principles, and encouraged them to continue to do even more to help the poor and the vulnerable. On Thursday, February the 9th, Pope Francis met with representatives of the magazine Civiltà Cattolica, Catholic Civilization. This magazine was founded in 1850 in Italy by the Society of Jesus. This week, the Civiltà Cattolica celebrates its 4,000th edition.
La vostra navigazione non è solitaria.
Your navigation is not solitary. My predecessors, from Blessed Pius IX to Benedict XVI, receiving you in audience, recognized on several occasions how your navigation is in the bark of St. Peter. The bond to the pontiff has always been an essential feature of your journal.
The magazine is available in Italian, English, French, Spanish, and Korean. As the magazine looks to build bridges with many peoples and cultures, Pope Francis praised the importance of poetry, art, and the intellectual content present in Civiltà Cattolica.
La crisi è globale.
The crisis is global. It is therefore necessary to focus our attention on the dominant cultural convictions and to the criteria through which people judge whether something is good or evil, desirable or not. Only a truly open way of thinking can face this crisis and understand where exactly the world is going, and how to face the more urgent and complicated issues, geopolitics, the economic challenges, and the humanitarian crisis related to migration.
Noto politico globale dei nostri giorni.
On the morning of February the 9th, the Holy Father welcomed the Congregation for Catholic Education on the occasion of its plenary assembly.
Anzitutto.
First of all, faced with an ever-increasing individualism, which makes us poor human beings and culturally sterile, It is necessary to rehumanize education. Schools and universities have meaning only in relation to the formation of the person.
The Holy Father said that Catholic education should transmit a culture of dialogue, because our world has become a global village in which each person belongs to humanity. He said that the Church takes special care of young people, and it hopes that the new generations will engage in dialogue to find new answers to the many challenges of our time.
Therefore, the real educator is like a father or a mother who can pass on a life building in the future. To have this spirit, we must listen to our youth, make an effort with our ears, listen to our youth. And we'll do this specifically at the next Synod of Bishops, which will be dedicated to young people.
Concluding his speech, Pope Francis thanked the Vatican's congregation for their work in making educational institutions also places of evangelization.
Vivimos en ciudades que construyen torres, centros comerciales, hacen negocios inmobiliarios.
In this February's video prayer intention, the Holy Father, Pope Francis, reaches out to the people who are abandoned or are in vulnerable situations. Titled Welcome the Needy, the video shows people frozen in all types of everyday actions. It represents the passive society, which has no consideration for those who suffer.
No los abandones.
Pope Francis' proposal is to go in the exact opposite direction, towards mercy. God's love can unfreeze our hearts so that society will become active in helping those who are in need.
Para que encuentren acogida y apoyo en nuestras comunidades.
February 11th of the year 2013, Pope Benedict XVI announced his decision to step down as the leader of the Catholic Church. This decision took the faithful by surprise, although resignation is a right of every pope.
Il Signore mi chiama a salire sul monte.
The Lord is calling me to scale the mountain, to devote myself even more to prayer and meditation. But this does not mean abandoning the Church. Indeed, if God asks me this, it is precisely so that I may continue to serve her with the same dedication and the same love with which I have tried to do so until now, but in a way more suited to my age and strength.
At first, Pope Benedict XVI announced his resignation to the cardinals gathered for a consistory in the Vatican's Apostolic Palace. Later, the announcement was communicated to journalists during a briefing at the Holy See press office. Father Federico Lombardi was the spokesperson for the Roman Pontiff at the moment of his resignation.
I found it from the very beginning as a wonderful decision, a decision taken in his spiritual, profound responsibility before God. And then I tried to interpret this also with the journalists, with the public, explaining the spirit in which he had taken this decision, and in accompanying also the last days of his pontificates and the preparation for the conclave.
As you know, I have decided, thank you for your kindness, to renounce the ministry which the Lord entrusted to me on the 19th of April 2005. I have done this in full freedom for the good of the Church, after much prayer and having examined my conscience before God, knowing full well the seriousness of this act.
I remember these days of being very near to him in his service for the Church and his responsibility for the Church. It was not a problem for me of preoccupation. It was a positive spiritual experience of working with him toward the end of his pontificates and in this very important step for the history of the Church. In particular with Ratzinger, for me it was a very profound experience of the situation of the sexual abuse story and the important work that he has done to help the Church for purification, for a correct attitude, for a culture of transparency and prevention. For the future. In this sense, this was an experience for me, it was a profound spiritual experience of suffering and of engagement for the renewal of the Church.
I am not abandoning the cross, but remaining in a new way at the sight of the crucified Lord. I no longer bear the power of office for the governance of the Church, but in the service of prayer I remain, so to speak, in the enclosure of St. Peter.
Francis likes very much the spiritual proximity of Benedict, in the sense that he prays really for the Church in general and also for his successor, obviously, because no one knows better than the predecessor what the successor has to do in this spiritual experience.
Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI continues to live in the Vatican at the Mater Ecclesia Monastery. Father Lombardi says that the Pope Emeritus still has a good memory and a clear mind. It's always a pleasure to speak with him, he says, and he always wears a smile on his face. He's gotten a bit weaker recently, but that's normal for a man who will turn 90 in just a few months. In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano. More on Vaticano begins now. Rome, the heart of the Catholic Church. One of its features is the constant presence of priests from all corners of the planet, priests of all ages, of all races, of all different cultures, who pass through the Eternal City for a visit, to study, and for some, to stay. In spite of the differences, there's a feeling of mutual help among all of them. An example of this we could witness at the Pontifical Spanish College of the Eternal City. After the Pontifical Venezuelan College was closed down due to the harsh economic crisis the country has been coping with, the Spanish College welcomed in its structure the Venezuelan priests that lived in Rome. José de San José Prisco, rector of the college, explains to us the reasons behind this decision.
There's a group of seven priests from Venezuela who has been incorporated into our structure because of the temporary closure of their college. This was because of the situation in their country and the difficulty of supporting it economically and other reasons too. And so the Venezuelan and the Spanish Episcopal Conferences came to an agreement so that these priests could be part of the Spanish College.
One of these Venezuelan priests is Alberto Márquez from the Diocese of Valencia. He's been a priest for 21 years, and he's currently doing his PhD in the Pontifical Lateran University.
We all feel very happy, above all because there's something uniting us, and that is the ministry of the service as presbyters, priests of the Church. And this transcends a lot of things, and we can live together more happily, more like an intercultural community, and that is necessary. It'll make us richer, us priests too. I do believe we're called to universality.
The Pontifical Spanish College was founded by Blessed Manuel Domingo y Sol in 1892 with the aim of offering training and tending to the needs of the Spanish seminarians and priests passing through Rome. Born in Tortosa, Spain, Manuel Domingo y Sol came to Rome accompanied by 13 seminarians exactly 125 years ago.
Don Manuel Domingo y Sol came with them from Spain in what were somewhat precarious conditions, with the purpose of making it possible for the Spanish clergy to train in Rome with few resources. So when they arrived in Rome, they were lodged in what is now the Spanish Church of Montserrat, which had a center for welcoming pilgrims. And there they lived for a while. The founder of the college, later beatified by John Paul II, the Blessed Manuel Domingo y Sol, and those first seminarians. They had few resources, but a lot of energy, which explains the success and impact their work has had. It's been now 125 years in the history of the church in Spain.
This year, the Spanish college will inaugurate the new block next to the main building. The new structure will welcome pilgrims going through Rome and will be equipped to attend to people with physical difficulties.
La casa está pensada para todo esto.
There are rooms designed for people with mobility problems, also with visual impairment. There are rooms parents can share with their children, and also areas for children to play in while their parents are resting. It's all being conceived to welcome entire families, because, well, this is something that the Church has always believed in very strongly, and recently Pope Francis keeps reminding us of that. We must take good care of our families.
And in the end, Rome offers a Catholic and a priest especially, something no other city can, the chance of sharing the faith in the heart of Christendom, next to the Pope, something no less than a milestone in the training and life of any priest.
Are this just Hollywood fantasies, or do these characters already exist?
I'll be back.
What?
Indestructible, humanized killing machines. Held at the United Nations in Geneva in December last year, the fifth review conference of the Convention on Conventional Weapons, CCW, was a great success for supporters of a ban on fully autonomous weapons, so-called killer robots. During their press meeting, the Campaign to Stop Killer Robots stressed that the moral and ethical aspects are a huge component of the issue.
How do human beings think it is okay to create weapon systems that, once programmed and set loose, on their own can go and target and kill human beings?
Madam President.
In their intervention during the conference, the Holy See cited that one of the stark realities of history is that most of the sophisticated and rapid scientific and technological developments have been driven by military logic or application.
Rather than being at the service of the greater common good, they have often led to the producing of deadly new weapons used to advance narrow national interests.
Our conviction is that every human conflict should come to an end by using peaceful means. You know, the message of the peace of this year is like that. But when you start talking about technical questions, we certainly are against complete and absolute and definitive, refusal of any use of automatic weapons. So it means absolute refusal of anything that would act against another human being, but would not be controlled by a human being.
123 participating nations voted to initiate official discussions on the danger of lethal autonomous weapon systems.
Pakistan is amongst one of those countries. Actually, we took a lead position. We've been taking it since the whole discussion started, that there should be a ban on lethal autonomous weapons. And therefore, we strongly support the campaign that has been undertaken by the campaign to ban killer robots.
And it's a good thing that by now 19 states have called for a ban. It's a good thing that 70 states have expressed concern. But it's moving too slow. Because if you have concerns, you should also translate your concerns into concrete actions. And so far, we're not that happy with the speed that the process is taking on.
The ban will be limited to those robots that are made only to kill, but does not include robots that are made to help.
We see autonomy and artificial intelligence being used for many beneficial purposes today, and civilian uses, also military uses. There are some useful purposes that you can use autonomy for there. But we draw the line when it comes to weapon systems and permitting a machine to take human life on the battlefield.
As international pressure mounts, this review conference was a key step toward a preemptive ban on deadly autonomous weapons. The UN established a group of government experts that will meet soon this year.
Thanks for watching. Stick around for more on Vaticano. Welcome back. You're watching Vaticano. Twitter. Today, it's one of the most used channels of communication for the exchange and distribution of news on current events. And it's in this public space that the family comes across quite positively. According to a study promoted by the Family and Media Research Group and carried out by Norberto González Gaetano, professor of public opinion at the Pontifical University of the Holy Cross, the family fares quite successfully on Twitter.
La sorpresa o el dato que emerge positivo es que
the surprise or the very positive data coming out is that values and the semantic fields related to family on Twitter are fundamentally positive. They concretely represent the social virtues of pietas, which is not piety as in commiseration, but reverence for our origin, our parents, the motherland, God.
Relación con el origen, que son los padres, que es la patria, que es Dios.
The research is based on a selection of tweets published in Spanish with the hashtag Familia. The results indicate the importance of the family topic in content posted on Twitter and the significant presence of anthropological values.
Que la imagen de la familia en Twitter es más positiva.
The image of the family on Twitter is more positive than the image we have from Hollywood, for example, or in magazines and newspapers. There's a lot less ideology, to put it in this way.
Another aspect shown in Professor Gaetano's analysis is who the main promoters of the family are on Twitter.
La sorpresa ha sido examinar, observar.
What was surprising was to examine and observe that everything being said about the family is promoted most of all by single individuals. What individuals say has much more resonance than what institutions say, or organizations, and political parties, the Catholic Church included. This is interesting as it shows that this social network is truly a social network, and for this it can better represent the public opinion, the opinion of the people, in contrast with the opinion of a few which has power, which is traditionally called the published opinion.
Que se llama tradicionalmente la opinión publicada.
The family and social media, two worlds apart, so it would seem, but two worlds united in their promotion of values and spaces more and more necessary to contemporary society. Twitter, like the family, has the possibility of becoming a network for interaction, for the dissemination and exchange of information on core issues affecting social life and the family. ...159 years ago, on February the 11th, a 14-year-old girl named Bernadette told her mother that a small young lady had spoken to her in the grotto of Massabielle, France. Who was the first apparition of the Immaculate Conception, better known as Our Lady of Lourdes. These apparitions were repeated on 17 occasions all throughout that year. During one of these apparitions, the small young lady told Bernadette to dig in the ground and drink from the spring she found there, to wash in it, and to eat the herb that grew there, as an act of penance. The next day, muddy waters had been cleared and fresh clear water flowed. The celebration of the Feast of Our Lady of Lourdes coincides with the World Day of the Sick established by St. John Paul II in 1992. This year, in the message addressed to the sick, Pope Francis offered his prayerful support and encouragement to health workers, nurses, volunteers, and all those consecrated men and women who are committed to serving the sick and those in need. The Holy Father wished that on this day we might find new incentives to work for the growth of a culture that respects life health, and the environment. Approximately 7,000 people reportedly have obtained different graces after visiting the shrine and drinking the water from the grotto. Of these, 68 have been declared a scientifically inexplicable miracle by both the Lourdes Medical Bureau and the Catholic Church. Nowadays, Lourdes has become one of the biggest Marian shrines in the world, welcoming millions of pilgrims every year. This place is a testimony to the humble faith of a 14-year-old girl named Bernadette and to her obedience, for she dug the ground for penance and found the spring, which became a source of numerous healings and a spiritual strength for the whole church.